be able to stand up and get involved. But that's not what witnesses do. So witness the words, the descriptions behind it, and then take it away. These words are very dense, and you can't possibly be expected to take everything in on one hearing. So please take this away, and at the end, if you think that it has meant something to you, and you know somebody else for whom it would speak, if there are extra copies, take them a copy. Okay? So we'll begin in just 1 minute.
Is it not strange the darkest hour that ever dawned on sinful earth should touch the heart with softer power for comfort than an angel's mirth? That to the cross the mourner's eye should turn sooner than where the stars of Christmas burn? Sooner than where the Easter sun shines glorious on you open grave, and to and fro the tidings run, who died to heal is risen to save. Sooner than where upon the Savior's friends the very comforter and light and love descends. Yet so it is, for duly there the bitter herbs of earth are set, till tempered by the Savior's prayer and with the Savior's life blood wet, they turn to sweetness and drop holy balm, soft as imprisoned martyrs' deathbed calm. All turn to sweet, but most of all, that bitterest to the lip of pride, when hopes presumptuous fade and fall, or friendship scorns us duly tried, or love, the flower that closes up for fear, when rude and selfish spirits breathe too near. Then like a long-forgotten strain comes sweeping o'er the heart forlorn, what sunshine hours had taught in vain, of Jesus' suffering, shame, and scorn. As in all lowly hearts he suffers still, while we triumphant ride and have the world at will. His pierced hands in vain would hide his face from rude reproachful gaze. His ears are open to abide the wildest storm the tongue can raise. He who with one rough word some early day their idle world and them shall sweep for aye away. But we by fancy may assuage the festering sore by fancy made, down in some lonely hermitage, like wounded pilgrims safely laid, where gentlest breezes whisper souls distressed, that love yet lives and patience shall find rest. Oh, shame beyond the bitterest thought that evil spirit ever framed, that sinners know what Jesus wrought, yet feel their haughty hearts untamed, that souls in refuge, holding by the cross, should wince and fret at this world's little loss. Lord of my heart, by thy last cry, let not thy blood on earth be spent. Lo, at thy feet I fainting lie. Mine eyes upon thy words are bent. Upon thy streaming wounds, my weary eyes wait like the parched earth on April skies. Wash me and dry these bitter tears. Oh, let my heart no further roam 'Tis thine by vows and hopes and fears. Long since, O call thy wanderer home, to that dear home, safe in thy wounded side, where only broken hearts their sin and shame may hide.
O sacred head, sore wounded, defiled and put to scorn, O kingly head surrounded with mocking crown of thorn, what sorrow mars thy grandeur? Can death thy bloom deflower? O countenance whose splendor the hosts of heaven adore, thy beauty long desired hath vanished from our sight. Thy power is all expired and quenched the light of light. Ah, me, for whom thou diest, hide not so far thy grace. Show me, O love most highest, the brightness of thy face. In thy most bitter passion, my heart to share doth cry, with thee for thy salvation upon the cross to die. Ah, keep my heart thus moved to stand thy cross beneath, to mourn thee, well-beloved, yet thank thee for thy death. What language shall I borrow to thank thee, dearest friend, for this thy dying sorrow, thy pity without end? Oh, make me thine forever, and should I fainting be, Lord, let me never outlive my love for thee. My days are few, O fail not, with thine immortal power, to hold me that I quail not in death's most fearful hour, that I might fight befriended, and see in my last strife to me thine arms extended upon the cross of life. Upon the cross of life.
Thank you. In old Jerusalem, there stirs a crowd within the temple court at Pesach tide. The smoke from sacrificial fires a cloud, as lambs are slaughtered, sins to set aside. Each righteous father does his duty well. His prayers arise according to the law. Across the city, up on Calvary Hill, another throng of seekers stands in awe, for here a lamb more precious than them all is sacrificed, a covering for our sin. He bows his head to hear the Father's call and breathes his last amid his weeping kin. This lamb, by death, shall trample death and rise, for none who follow after truly dies.
Beneath the cross of Jesus, I fain would take my stand, the shadow of a mighty rock within a weary land, a home within the wilderness, a rest upon the way, from the burning of the noontide heat and the burden of the day. Upon the cross of Jesus, my eyes at times can see the very dying form of one who suffered there for me. And from my stricken heart, with tears to wonders, I confess the wonders of redeeming love and my unworthiness. I take, O cross, thy shadow for my abiding place. I ask no other sunshine than the sunshine of his face. Content to let the world go by, to know no gain nor loss, my sinful self my only shame, my glory, all the cross.
Oh. since it was the day of preparation. The Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because the Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified, so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled. None of his bones shall be broken. And again, another passage of scripture says, they will look on the one whom they have pierced. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the people, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Christ. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices and linen clothes, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified. And in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the day of preparation, and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there.
The three men hang together, side by side upon their crosses on a lonely hill. The one speaks up, intending to deride, "Oh, save yourself and us just by your will." The other chided, "Have you no respect? Even in the face of death, no fear of God? O Lord, remember me among the elect." And Jesus turned and answered with a nod. The honest thief was taken in surprise when Jesus spoke to him these words of love, "This day you'll be with me in paradise," and gazed with holy eyes to heaven above. May we, like him, be bold to ask our way, if even to the final hour delay.
What wondrous love is this, O my soul? What wondrous love is this that caused the Lord of bliss to send his precious peace to my soul? When I was sinking down beneath God's righteous frown, Christ laid aside his crown for my soul. Ye winged seraphs, fly, bear the news. Ye winged seraphs, fly like comets through the sky. Fill vast eternity with the news. Ye friends of Zion's King, join the praise. Ye friends of Zion's King, with hearts and voices sing, and strike each tuneful string in his praise. To God and to the Lamb I will sing. To God and to the Lamb, who is the great I am. While millions join the theme, I will sing. And while from death I'm free, I'll sing on. And while from death I'm free, I'll sing and joyful be. And through eternity, I'll sing on.
Thank you. Let man's soul be a spear, and then in this, the intelligence that moves, devotion is, and as the other spears, by being grown, subject to foreign motion, lose their own, and being by others hurried every day, scarce in a year their natural form obey. Pleasure or business, so our souls admit, for their first mover in our world by it. Hence is it that I am carried towards the west, this day when my soul's form bends toward the east. There I should see a sun by rising set, and by that setting, endless day beget. But that Christ on his cross did rise and fall, sin had eternally benighted all. Yet dare I always be glad, I do not see that spectacle of too much weight for me. Who sees God's face? That is self-life, must die. What a death were it then to see God die. It made his own lieutenant, nature, shrink. It made his footstool crack and the sun wink. Could I behold those hands which span the poles and tune all spears at once, pierced with those holes? Could I behold that endless height, which is zenith to us and our antipodes, humbled below us, or that blood, which is the seat of all our souls, if not of his, made dirt of dust, or that flesh which was worn by God for his apparel, rage and torn? If on these things I dare not look, dare I upon his distressed mother cast mine eye? Who was God's partner here and frontaged thus half of that sacrifice which ransomed us? Though these things, as I ride, be from mine eye, they're present yet into my memory. For that looks towards them, and thou lookest towards me. O Savior, as thou hangest upon the tree, I turn my back to thee, but to receive corrections, till thy mercies bid thee leave. O think we worth thine anger, punish me, burn off my rust and my deformity. Restore thine image so much by thy grace that thou mayest know me, and I'll turn my face.
My song is love unknown, my Savior's love to me, love to the loveless shown, that they might lovely be. Oh, who am I, that for my sake, my Lord should take frail flesh and die? He came from his blessed throne salvation to bestow, but men cared not, and none the longed for Christ would know. But oh, my friend indeed, who at my need his life did spend. Sometimes they strew his way and his sweet praises sing, resounding all the day, hosannas to the king. Then crucify is all their breath, and for his death they thirst and cry. Why? What hath my Lord done? What makes this rage and spite? He made the lame to run. He gave the blind their sight. Sweet injuries. Yet all his deeds their hatred feeds. They 'gainst him rise. They rise, and needs will have my dear Lord sent away. A murderer they save. Prince of life they slay. Yet willing he to suffering goes that his foes from thence might free. In life, no house, no home my Lord on earth might have. In death, no friendly tomb. But what a stranger gave. What may I say? Heaven was his home, but mine the tomb wherein he lay. Here might I stay and sing, no story so divine. Never was love, dear king, never was grief like thine. This is my friend, in whose sweet praise I all my days could gladly spend.
Thank you.
alone to sacrifice, thou goest, Lord, giving thyself to death whom thou wilt slay. For us, thy wretched folk, is any word whose sins have brought thee to this agony? For they are ours, O Lord, our deeds, why must thou suffer torture for our sin? Let our hearts suffer for thy passion, Lord, that very suffering may thy mercy win. This is that night of tears, the 3 days space, sorrow abiding of the eventide, until the day break with the risen Christ, and hearts that sorrowed shall be satisfied. So may our hearts share in thine anguish, Lord, that they may be, that they may shares of thy glory be. Heavy with weeping, may the 3 days pass to win the laughter of thine Easter day.